almost drive me crazy. Got a gal named Daisy. She almost drive me crazy. She knows how to love me, yes indeed. But you don't know what she do to me. Tootie fruity, oh Rudy. 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 Pop, pop, blue mom.
Cars, we do love them. But what possesses people to spend thousands of pounds on an old banger? Is probably less reliable than the new coupe they got sitting on their driveway. So we've come along to this classic car show here in Clacton to find out exactly why people do love restoring old cars. But first, let's take a look at a couple of cars and their star owners. The 550 Spider. Now there's a beautiful car. The 550's racing success has been a major, if not the major, contributing factor to Porsche's commercial success. From the Le Mans in 1953 to 1955, the Porsche Spider was a force to be felt on the track. And needless to say, a certain young actor made the Porsche even more infamous than it already was.
Ladies and gentlemen, James Dean. Hi, Jimmy.
Hi, Gig.
We asked Jimmy over today because he's a racing man himself. A real one, not a crazy one.
On September 30th, 1955, James Dean was driving his new 550 Porsche Spider to Salinas, where he planned to enter into a race. At 5:45 p.m. and at the intersection of Highway 41 and Route 466, a 1950 Ford turned in front of Dean's car and he was unable to get around it. James Dean died in 1955 at the tender age of just 24. Since James Dean's death, the Porsche 550 Spider has become infamous as the car that killed him. The name Little Bastard was given by Dean's language coach Bill Hickman and was later painted on the car by a master pinstriper, Dean Jeffries. On September the 23rd of 1955, Dean met actor Alec Guinness outside of a restaurant and took him to look at the Spider. Guinness told Dean that the car had a sinister appearance and then told Dean, "If you get in that car, you will be found dead in it by this time next week." 7 days later, Dean would be killed in his beloved 550 Spider. That 550 not only killed James Dean, but killed and maimed others who came into contact with it, causing many to say that the car itself was cursed. George Barris, who customised the 550 originally, bought the wrecked carcass of Little Bastard for $2,500, and soon after it slipped off its trainer and broke a mechanic's leg. Not long after, Barris sold the engine and drivetrain to Troy McHenry and William Eshrid. While the two are racing against one another, in cars that had parts from Dean's 550, McHenry lost control and hit a tree, killing him instantly. And Eshrid was seriously injured when his car suddenly locked up and rolled over while going into a turn. Barris still had two tyres from the 550, which were untouched in Dean's accident. He sold them, and not long after, both blew out simultaneously, causing the owner's car to run off the road. Due to all the incidents involving the 550, Barris decided to hide the car, but was convinced by the California Highway Patrol to lend the cursed heap to a highway safety exhibit. The first exhibit was unsuccessful as the garage that housed the car caught fire and burned to the ground. Mysteriously, the car suffered virtually no damage from the fire. The next exhibition at a local high school ended abruptly when the car fell off its display and broke a nearby student's hip. The curse continued when the 550 was being transported, when the truck carrying the car lost control, which caused the driver to fall out and somehow get crushed by the car after it fell off the back. The car fell off two more transport trucks when travelling on the highway, fortunately not injuring anyone. The California Highway Patrol decided it had had enough of the 550, and while transporting the car to Barris, the car mysteriously vanished and has not been seen since.
Do you have any special advice for the young people who drive?
Take it easy driving. The life you might save might be mine.
I'm here, just like I said.
Another classic car lover is singer Will Young. He gave this interview to a national tabloid on the 14th of February 2010. Cars are in my blood. I think it's because of my granddad. He had old Jags, 120s, 140s, and I think he had an E-Type, an Alfa Romeo Spider, and Fiat's. He also had a Bristol, and now so do I. It might not be pretty, but I love the 80s styling. I used to go past the Bristol showroom in Kensington and steam up the windows looking in. I love the Brigand's Lions. in a way, it's quite ugly, especially at the back. It reminds me of the BMW 3-litre CSI, which was made in the 70s, but I like that massive back windscreen. Then it's got the long bonnet, the line of the old Ford Cortina, so it's just like my idea of perfection. I sit in the front room and look out of the window at my car. I've been all over the country in it already. It's quite a good cruiser. Quick and massive engine, it's 5.8 litres. I only took delivery of it 3 months ago. It's been 3 weeks since I last drove it, so I really must take it out for a spin, even if it's just to run up to Hampstead to get a coffee. I'm not rich enough to buy a supercar. My Bristol and Porsche 356 together are not as much as a new Maserati. But I like old cars. They are more individual and more romantic. Modern cars can feel a bit sterile. Maybe I'm making life really difficult for myself and I should go and get a Mercedes 4x4. I mean, the windows of the Brigand don't work already and the radio's gone a bit, even though it's been done up to perfection. I'd love to have a new Porsche, the 4S, but I just don't think I could justify the spending all that money on the modern car. Besides, it's important to keep a low profile. I was going to a gig about 3 years ago and I thought, I'll test drive the BMW Z4, but I couldn't believe the amount of abuse I got from the people in those 2 days. It was a weird combination of fame and having this nice car. There's something about it that's not me. Owning a Bristol is similar to being on my bike. People don't notice me. And if they do, they're really friendly, more so than they would be normally. The car I had previously was an Audi A3, a 1.8 litre turbo. I bought that 18 months after I won Pop Idol, and I was noticed everywhere. I considered getting blacked out windows, but that would have looked really bad. I'm much happier with my Bristol.
Get a wiggly worm and then you watch him squirm while you put him on a hook and then you drop him in the brook.
Back at Clacton Classic Car Show, the sun was shining and everyone was having a great time. I decided to stop and talk to one of the exhibitors who was proud to show off his pride and joy.
What's your name, please?
Bernie Hedworth.
Bernie Hedworth.
Hedworth, H-E-A-D-W-R, as in big head.
Lovely, thank you for that. And what's your age?
I'm 79.
And what car model is this?
It's a 1936 four-seater Morris 8 Tourer. The first car I had in my life was an Austin 7.
And what are your general likes about cars?
What do I like?
Yeah.
It's just that I was a child when these was running about. And I have more nostalgic for those than later models. It took us 18 months from to get it like this, 18 months of solid work, two of us, about 3 days a week. As to the money, I wouldn't like to even calculate it, because if I calculate it, it'd frighten the life out of me. I'll never get my money back on it.
No.
Can't do that.
No, just labor.
It's just a hobby.
Yeah.
But then all hobbies cost money, don't they?
Absolutely, yeah, and it's quite an interesting one to have, I would have thought.
Yeah, and I keep an interest, because I'm getting old, it keeps me interested in things.
How did you become interested in classic cars?
Well, I was always interested in old cars. Old cars appealed to me more than new cars, and it's quite a challenge when you get a wreck and you can eventually get it to go. And coming to these shows, it gives so many people. They come up to you and they say, oh, I remember my father having one of those. I can remember going on holiday. And you'd be surprised what it does for other people. Well, this one's been on the road for 4 years and it does about 8 shows a year. Like, on average, about 8 shows a year.
And the furthest show being?
I don't like driving more than 60 or 70 miles in a day. It's only broken down once. On the A12, and it was a condenser. It was the only thing I hadn't got.
Right.
It's only a small electrical part. I then had to be towed home that day.
All right. Have you had any light moments, quite amusing moments with people watching and not watching when they're going? Or
a lady said to me last week at Kirby Church, I remember one of those. She said, I have very strong memories of that. Me and my sister, we were little girls, we were all dressed up in our Sunday clothes, the hood was taken down, we were sat in the back, she said, and we went down the road and suddenly we hit this great big puddle. And she said the water came right up over the top, splashed down and landed on some back seat.
Gun got cloud and started to rain. I tooted my horn for the passing lane. Rainwater blowing all under my hood.
It seems that people don't mind spending a small fortune on their cars, because at the end of the day it's a hobby and all hobbies cost money. Whilst walking about the car show, I spotted this beautiful example of a Buick Riviera and went over to have a quick chat with the owner.
What's your name?
Boise Turner.
Boise Turner?
Yeah.
Age?
Age? You're asking me age?
69. Lovely face. That's a funny one, though. Car model? What car model? Is
Buick 1958 Buick Super Riviera. First ever car was a 1948 Chevrolet.
Just to own it, or
yeah? No.
Have you got any dislikes about modern day driving cars now, or any classics or anything?
No, not really. No, I think you just got to accept what they are now, haven't you? You know, I mean, I've got a 1988 Audi 100. You know, but I like all cars really. You know, but my favourite is American cars. It's 364 cubic inch. That's 5.9 litre, and the top speed's got 120 on the clock, but I've been past that, and I broke the speed. It cost me $500 to get it repaired.
Because you went over the speed?
Yeah, that's it, yeah. Well, I brought this in 1974. We've had it. I used to tow a 20-foot caravan with it, and I used it up to 81, and then it stood in the garage. I retired in 05, and spent 2 years restoring it, finishing it in 07. And that's how you see her now, finished.
How did you become interested in classic cars?
Well, from that 1948 Buick, Chevrolet, you know, and from there on I've had Corvairs and everything, different types, Fords, everything, you know. I just like the chrome and everything and the way, the solidness of them, you know, classic cars.
Real cars.
Well, today they're all plastic, aren't they?
And Euro-styled as well.
Well, yeah, yeah. They're not going to last like these ones, are they?
No, that's it.
You know.
Is this the only classic project you've worked on?
No, I've done a 1963 Corvair Monza, 1965 Corvair Monza. I repair all the. I brought them with the engines damaged, and I sprayed them and everything. You know, 52 Sunliner, I sprayed, so I used to run. You know, all different types. I do my own mechanics and that. You see.
Do you tend to use them day to day, or are they purely in the garage?
We used to use this as a daily driver. Well, I used to tow that 20-foot caravan. I've been all around Cornwall on it and that. You know, but now she's not a daily. You can't afford to leave them. You know, it's like at a show, there's always one of us with it all the time. You know, it's a thing.
Is this your first show, or have you been too many, or even won awards?
Oh, no, I've got about, I think it's 18, 19 awards now on the sideboard. I go to as many of the shows as I can. I was up for Car of the Year last year at the NEC. There was eight of us up there for it. I was a runner-up, you know, I didn't win it. But that was a three-day contest thing. That was for Classic American. You know, but I'll go to as many as I can. There's Battles Bridge next week.
Right, yeah.
There is.
From Chicago to LA, more than 2,000 miles.